So welcome, everybody. Welcome to Windsor Regional Hospital. Today is one of those great days that we will remember for quite some time. It's amazing news. We received today officially from the Ministry of Health and Cancer Care Ontario. The news we received that they have made public is the fact that our Erie St. Clair Lynn, our Windsor Essex community, and in particular Windsor Regional Hospital is going to be the benefactor of a brand new PET CT scanner for our Holy Erie St. Clair Lynn. It's going to be located here at our Met campus. The great news about this is the fact that it will be funded fully by the Ministry of Health and Cancer Care Ontario, which is a first in the province of Ontario. Traditionally, any type of hospital equipment has to be purchased by the hospital through donations and our hospital operating budget. The exception of that is some cancer center equipment, like the radiation machines, which are purchased through Cancer Care Ontario. Cancer Care Ontario now is going to be supporting a program across the province to procure and fund PET CT scanners for hospitals across the province of Ontario and replacing those that need replacing. We are the first benefactor of that new process that's been put in place. So that's great news for our region. Again, we always love to be first. So in this case, we are first. I have with me some individuals who will come up, who will talk about what is a PET scanner, PET CT scanner, what does it do, how many patients are we planning to serve in our region, and what's it different from an MRI, a CT, other types of diagnostic imaging equipment, and how it is leading technology, not only across Ontario, across Canada, but across the world. From my understanding, there are now 14 such PET CT scanners across the province, and we will have one that will be up and running brand new, and our goal is to have it up and running by December of 2018. So it's a very tight timeline with respect to getting this moving. So over to my right is an actual photo of what a PET CT scanner looks like. What we have to do as the next step is go out in a procurement process to procure the PET CT. So you know Cancer Care Ontario has provided us the sum of up to $3.5 million to procure it. So we're talking about a rather expensive piece of equipment. To give you an example, an MRI traditionally costs right around $1.5 million. So it's a very expensive piece of equipment, and that's why there are so few of them in Ontario. And up to this point, they had to be either through hospital operations or fundraising to support them.
How much did you say they cost?
Up to $3.5 million. Did I say that the first time?
No.
Or did I say something different?
No, I think you did.
Did I say billion?
I did have one other dollar question. So they're funding the equipment. What about the training and operating costs?
So they will fund the training and operating costs. So they will fund the per scan costs, just like we get monies now for MRI, CTs, is we will get a per scan reimbursement fee. And also any difference between what they're funding and what we need to install it will be supported by the Windsor Cancer Center Foundation, has agreed to step up and fund the any installation costs, because I'm gonna show you where it's gonna be installed, which is a little trick for our campus, and an example of how we installed something past years at our campus. So I have just a few slides to pop you through. This is our Windsor Regional Met campus. So you see Kildare on the left. At the top is Lenz Avenue, and I'll go through it. So this is a side view to give you an example. You'll see Tecumseh Road is along the top, Alsace Avenue along the side, Kildare on the left, Alsace, and Bing. Okay, everyone got the kind of the coordinates where we're, what we're looking at. So what we have is the front hospital entrance with all of you probably came through today. And then we have the cancer center entrance off the back corner there. And What I'm going to do is the next slide is going to be a close-up view of the area that's dotted. So that's the area that's dotted. And what we have, an existing open area. Radiation therapy is located there. The MRI currently is located right next to the open area. And that's where the PET scanner is going to go. So basically it is an open area that is surrounded by hospital buildings. And it's immediately adjacent to the existing MRI at this campus. And immediately, both of those are immediately adjacent to the cancer center, which is down here. To give you.
Can you say open area, like an open area in the hospital, or like it's, you need to enclose the area?
So it's surrounded. So what we're going to do, good question. So what we're going to be doing is our procurement is going to be an actual built-in unit, and the PET scan will be inside of it, and it will be delivered to the site and put into that spot. So it's going to be self-enclosed, built. And then for all those individuals that are talking about, well, you're going to be moving, why would you make this investment? It's pretty much going to have wheels, okay? So if it has any life left by the time we have to move to the new acute, just like other equipment, it will be moved to the new acute facility, okay? So it's going to be self-enclosed. So pretty much the concept's going to be, and that's why our goal is to get it up and running by December. It's going to be built, and Jeff can talk about this, but Jeff Riche, but it's going to be plug and play. Is we're going to put it, drop it in, plug it in, you know, that site will be ready for it. And in effect, it's going to share the same waiting room as the MRI does now. As the waiting room from the MRI will now service also the PET scanner.
So all of the screens, the readouts will be within this unit, all self-contained?
Yes, it'll be self-contained, and then they'll be outside as well. There'll be some things out in the waiting room area too, right?
Will it be the kind of thing where you drop it in with a crane, that sort of?
That's where the existing cancer center and MRI is. So again, it's a bigger shot to give you an idea of where this is going to be located next to the MRI. And just to give you a memory, flashback, is that's when we installed the MRI, is we had to crane it in. So this time is going to be a little bit different. We're going to offer a lottery, and if anyone wants to stand on top of there when it's going in to be dropped in, we'll do a fundraiser, they can be part of that and be dropped in. So if you're up for it, we can get you up there, Peter. And probably because Craig was late, Craig can do it, right?
He
can
hold on. He'll be on the
wrong
across
the street anyway.
Yeah, there you go. You can watch it going. So that's the way it's going to be. That's the actual MRI, but this will be a self-enclosed type of structure that will be dropped in with the PET scanner inside of it.
It'll be, when you say self-contained, it'll have its own HVAC and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, it's gonna, you know, we've gotta plug it into, you know, you gotta plug it in, get it running. But yeah, it'll be all, it'll be self-contained. Now technically, if we needed to, you could move it again, right? So that's the goal, but if you had to do that. But, so for instance, there's what's called a hot lab. We have a hot lab right outside of that area, so the issue will be whether it's built in with a hot lab or not. So, kind of one of the things we got to talk about too is this is what in the past we've been discussing. As we move towards a new acute care hospital, these are the types of announcements and things that are going to continue to happen. So we've gone out of our way to under-promise and over-deliver, because people will say, oh, you're not going to have any additional services at the new acute care hospital. Why are we even moving to a new acute care hospital? Folks, there are going to be additional services at the acute care hospital. There's going to be more services at the acute care hospital we have now, and we're going to be able to retain and recruit, as we're already seeing right now, more professionals that want to be part of either the new acute care hospital planning and or being part of the medical school. Those are two game changers in our community that have happened with respect to recruitment of healthcare professionals. It's exciting time. And announcements like this have a lot to do with that. It's with respect to being able to move towards a new acute care hospital and have the technology. So it's not a shock that we were the first in the province to benefit from this program. And that's great news. We work very closely with Cancer Care Ontario. I'm in the Ministry of Health, and this is a huge announcement because it's a significant investment not only in Windsor Essex and for the Erie St. Clair Lynn, but it's a significant investment for the rest of the province moving forward. Having PET scanners at this price, funded now through Cancer Care Ontario by the Ministry of Health, and machines replaced across the province, plus clearly the investment in the operating costs, the annual operating costs, is a significant investment. And kudos to the Ministry of Health, the new Minister of Health, and Cancer Care Ontario. So we're really, really excited. So you heard enough from me. I'm going to call up the team. Maybe you can all stand up, kind of. So the goal is they'll answer any questions you might have. Maybe that's the best way to do it. And to talk about what is a PET CT, the patient population we're going to be serving, how many we're going to be doing a year approximately to start, what's the projected growth, and what are the benefits for cancer patients. So I'll let the team.
So good afternoon. I'm Monica Staley-Yang, and I'm the Regional Vice President for Cancer Care Ontario in Erie St. Clair, our renal and patient relations and legal affairs here at Windsor Regional Hospital. So as David said, it's an extremely happy and exciting day for all of our patients and families and community throughout Erie St. Clair to have this amazing announcement of a new PET scanner for our area, and so that we can service our patients and families closer to home and have access in a timely way. So me and my team here are very excited.
So tell us what the difference is between this scanner and the type of equipment that's available here now.
So my name is Cindy Cantrell. I'm the Chief of Oncology. I'm a medical oncologist and hematologist. So, there's different types of technology, and probably Jeff can speak about the technology details a bit better, but we often use CAT scans and MRIs to diagnose and to assess response to treatment. So PET and PET CT are another type of technology they're different. CTs and MRIs show you anatomy, whereas PET CT can show you anatomy plus tissue function and how it's responding to treatment. So it adds a whole other layer of information than what we have with traditional anatomic imaging. And in terms of uptake, there are ever-expanding indications for PET scans, especially in the cancer world. It's a careful sort of progression, though, because sometimes you can overplay the use of PET scans and they can actually mislead you. So it's under, we choose who needs a PET and CT scan very carefully. Probably three most common indications that we use PET CT would be for staging of cancer, to assess response to treatment, and then also if we're worried about recurrence, it can be helpful in certain situations.
So where is the closest one available now, the outside tissues?
Well, we've been very lucky in Windsor now and also before because we've had a PET CT here in Windsor that Dr. Tracy has been running. And so we've been very fortunate. Many patients in Windsor have benefited from that, and he's run an excellent unit. So we've had that access, and we're going to continue to have that access.
Will this be able to image in motion or still?
It's still, but it's still imaging. Yeah. But it really is much more complex, and you see the pictures in a whole different kind of view.
So did patients have to go out of town before, or they could have stayed in town anyway and gone to Dr. Tracy?
Generally, patients have been able to stay in town. There have been some times when they've had to leave, but it's worked well. Yes.
And why will having one at the hospital be better?
Maybe I'll ask them to see the rest.
So historically, almost 60% of the patients were done in the independent Dr. Tracy's PET scan. However, sometimes when it was down, our patients would have to go outside, and most of those patients would either go to London or Hamilton. So there was still some patients who would have to travel. Because of our new PET scan, it's state-of-the-art equipment. It's new, it's operationalized by Cancer Care Ontario, and we will be able to have consistent, timely access close to home. So it just, it negates anybody having to travel. And it also, as David said, we are the first of a long time Cancer Care Ontario strategy. So when we look to our regions for help, to help us with access and capacity issues, we also have to be mindful and cognizant that they have increased volumes. And so currently we look to do about approximately 600, but clearly with the growth in the volumes we see, we'll be expecting to go up to 1,000 in a few years.
Do patients have to wait some time to get in if they need one? Is that what's happening now? Will that cut down on some of those waits?
There has been periods of time where there have been waits, and so I think this will help mitigate some of those issues with wait times and travel.
How long would the wait time be, roughly?
Well, when we would get into operational issues here in Windsor, we would look to London and Hamilton to help support our patients to travel. Some patients, though, based on, you know, their age or what their disease process was, would not want to travel. And also, again, we would have to rely on the capacity and volume issues of London. So it could be anywhere from 2 to 4 weeks. Now, I have to say our neighboring LHINs always tried to help us when the PET went down, but this will help, and with new PET scan and its new equipment, it will really, you know, minimize that issue.
What wait time do you hope it will drop to?
Well, I think if we're able to reschedule, it's here, it's our team scheduling, I think we will be able to easily do within the 2 week period as we deal with the volumes.
And are there particular types of cancer that this is extremely useful for, or is it broad across all types of cancer?
Like I said, that research and the evidence for different kinds of cancers expanding. So I'd say that it's not the right scan for every cancer, but there are some that it's especially good for. So lymphomas are very good. We use it routinely in lung cancer, esophageal cancer, colorectal cancer. Those are sort of a few of them. And they're also the most common ones that we deal with.
I know you tried to explain this. What is it that the PET CT scanner allows you to see that you can't with the other imaging equipment?
So, Jeff Risch, I'm the director of radiation oncology here. So, a PET CT is a hybrid imaging device. So, there's a PET component and a CT component. So, the CT is a basic diagnostic CT, similar to the kind of CT that we run downstairs, but the one that we have downstairs we use for regular diagnosis is a little fancier. The PET part is where what we're paying for. The PET is a series of detectors. The patient's injected with a radioactive isotope of fluorine. That isotope is taken up in areas of the body where there's active metabolic activity, so areas like where cancers grow. Then we put them inside the PET scanner. We detect where those positrons are being emitted from. It's positron emission tomography. Then they go through the CT component. So that gives us the underlying anatomy, but it also allows us to correct for some attenuation in the patient's body. And the technology that we're going after is the cutting edge PET scanner that is available right now in Canada.
So a lot of this is driven by the power of the computers and the software that allows you to merge those two bits of information.
That's right.
And it could cost up to $3.5 million. How much might it cost to run annually?
That's a good question.
Still to be determined. So,
yeah.
That's kind of the next part of the announcement is we'll be working with Cancer Care Ontario with respect to the operating budget with an estimated first allotment of approximately 600 scans. And it's a provincial rate across the whole province. I don't have it handy what they pay because we haven't been in the business before. What it does, it pays enough to continue to operate the machine. There'll be monies for the maintenance of the machine and, of course, the staff that are needed. The physicians themselves will be billing OGIP separate and apart for their fee involved. So the goal is, over time, what Cancer Care Ontario does, similar in chemotherapy and other treatments, radiation, is they give you a general budget estimated upon the volumes that you estimate you're going to need. And then as you get closer into the second and third quarter of an operating year, then you start projecting to the end of the year, and they start discussing about, okay, it looks like you're gonna need, instead of 600, we're gonna do 800. What does that budget look like? And how do we need to revise it? Or at the end of the year, they look at your full year and make a decision to say, okay, you exceeded it based upon demand and we'll compensate you at that point. So it's a progress that you work through. In addition to cancer patients though, it does currently, locally, some cardiology cases, as well as it extends now into neurology cases as well, for patients with neurological issues.
How will you decide who gets access to the machine, whether it is a neurology case or a cardiac case?
I think there's very clear, indications for when PET is useful. So as clinicians, we're very aware of that, and so if there's a good indication for a PET scan, we should have access to
it. It'll be a pretty clear process.
So once it's up and running in December, what's the relationship with the private clinic that currently has a scanner? How will you coordinate, or will you coordinate?
Yeah, so actually, we've talked to Dr. Tracy. Dr. Tracy is the head of our nuclear medicine department here at the hospital. So he will be the medical head for this scanner internally. And then we have to work on a transition plan to make sure that we see the volumes that the team was talking about, that we avoid having anyone go to London or Hamilton at that point.
So is the idea to have both running sort of indefinitely? Or
no, so Dr. Tracy will work on his own private situation with respect to his machine. Again, it's older, and as Monica stated, it over time, unfortunately, it had some, and I think this was in the media, on with respect to breakdowns. Not to say a new machine doesn't break down, but it was older, right? So, and that was part of the difficulty. So, right. So there was some issues there. So.
So you won't use that one at all, Dr. Tracy?
We won't. So we'll be using the one here at the hospital. So it should be able to meet all of the volumes and demands. And the other thing about PET CTs, from my understanding, is the actual diagnostic test is a lot longer than like a CT or even an MRI.
Yep.
Is the length is a lot longer. So there is an issue with respect to that.
With throughput. So you inject them, and then the patient has to wait for you give the patient the injection, they have to wait for about 45, 55 minutes before they can even be put into the scanner. And then the scan itself takes some time. So you are limited a little bit by the throughput because of the process. But we hopefully can get up to about 8 to 10 patients per day. And that's pretty high volume for a PET CT.
What, the whole pretty much 24/7 or?
Well, we'll have to visit that as the operational donors support it.
What roughly are the dimensions of that machine?
That's a good question. It's a lot bigger than the picture of the MRI that was up there. And it's not so much the dimensions kind of across the side of the photo as it is the dimension into the bore. It's a lot deeper machine because you have the detector rings for the PET, and then you have the CT scanner part kind of sandwiched onto the back. The patient has to go all the way through.
Would you hire anybody new for this?
Yeah, we'll have new, some of the existing staff are already trained to operate a PET CT, the nuclear medicine staff that are there already. So it's just a matter of working that through over the next 9 months with respect to the needs and developing the operating budget.
I'm sorry, but there will be new staff?
There could be, but I don't know the exact qualifications of existing staff. Yeah, so they might be able to continue on. Again, this is late breaking in the sense of just pulling it together. So we haven't focused on now. That's over the next couple of months of developing the operating budget, looking at existing staff, their qualifications from both campuses to determine who wants to be part of the operation of this. There's a whole process of posting and all that kind of stuff.
So presumably you'll have to wait till the procurement process to know what exact machine you're getting to begin training specifically.
Yeah, there could be some uniqueness with the actual product.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there's no one currently that works for Windsor Regional Hospital who's worked on one of these machines, right? We don't have the technology. So when we go through the procurement process, factory training, that those people might have to do.
How long has this been on Windsor's wish list?
Oh boy, you know, it's one of those things that we were talked about it about 2 years ago when there were some issues publicly. And it's such an expensive piece of capital equipment. It's one of those that if we had $3.5 million, we would spend it on other things before we spent it on this. So that was kind of always our answer. And we said, as we move towards a new acute care hospital, this is something that definitely we're gonna plan for in the new acute care hospital. So for us to be approached to say, we wanna come up with, we're coming up with this provincial plan, and we know you want a PET scan, PET CT scan, and we know you need a PET CT scan, we want you to be first to be part of this project is fantastic news. So it's not every day someone hands you $3.5 million, especially for medical equipment. The cancer program has it with respect to radiation machines, which help out significantly. But this is definitely, in my lifetime, the most expensive piece of equipment. I'm looking around the room with respect to diagnostic imaging that we're gonna be procuring. I mean, it dwarfs anything else we've purchased by almost double.
What's the lifespan? What's the lifespan of the, like how long will it last for?
Well, I mean, ideally, PET CT should go no problem, 10 to 12 years. The real challenge and why PETs haven't been lasting quite that long is because the technology is constantly changing. So the detectors are getting better, the electronics are getting faster, and they're building these systems a lot more sophisticated than they used to. So you always want to try and stay on that leading edge. So that's why when we go for this procurement, we want to buy the best possible machine that's available on the market currently, so that'll give us the best possible chance of longevity.
And with two machines operating, at least when it comes out, when you get this one online, like how much of a proportion will the new one take of all the scans in Windsor?
Well, I can say that when they're referred to us, we're gonna do whatever comes in our doors.
Okay.
And I think Dr. Tracy still has to figure out how he's gonna manage his own practice.
Okay.
Yep.
But again, he'll be here at the hospital.
So he'll be running
leading
both.
This, yeah. Leading this PET CT nuclear medicine program currently. So he'll be leading that from a physician leadership point of view. I'm in the team. So again, the tentative, I think it's in the press release, they said it's approximately 600 scans a year. Again, our projections show that we're servicing about 60% locally now. Unfortunately, 40% have to travel to London and or Hamilton, and some of them are in the room, that have to travel that distance.
That was me.
That was him. That's Jeff. So he's not only doing the filming, he can speak to,
yeah.
Yeah, to Hamilton. I had a PET scan 9 years ago.
Which one?
Yeah. No, I had a PET
here,
scan.
Here, consider it, because they weren't
wow.
Here. It's important.
Yeah, I had a PET scan 9 years ago, almost actually to the week, 9 years ago, and it was a pretty crazy process in that we couldn't get into London, so we had to go stay overnight the night before in Hamilton and then get up early in the morning for the scan. It took about 45 minutes, an hour for the injection, and then through the scanner itself, and there was some type of error, so it actually ended up having to do it a second time. And it's not an easy scan to do. It's not just laying there. I had a lymphoma, and it was mainly around my throat area, so I had to have my hands over my head, and actually it was quite painful. I had a new baby at home and everything, so no, this is really exciting. I'm super excited to have this here. Really, really, really big good news.
Yeah, how hard was it having to go out of town for that?
I had a new baby at home. My wife and my daughter couldn't come. My cousin's husband actually ended up coming with me to just be with me in the waiting room, and he was awesome. It's not something that you want to do when you're going through something like that. You don't want to leave home. Nobody does. Like, I don't want to leave where my friends and my family are that are supporting me. So.
And what were you diagnosed with?
I had non-Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Okay, well, just here, he's not only.
Just so we can pick up the names later, just name and title if you don't mind. I know we are.
Jeff Casey, cancer survivor.
Thanks, Jeff.
So, and also here before we wrap up is Colleen Ream. Colleen's a representative of the Windsor Cancer Center Foundation, And as stated, if there is any gap for the installation costs, as the Cancer Center Foundation has agreed to pick that up and pay that. So we reached out to them recently and said, this is coming, are you interested? And they said, yes. There will not be a specific fundraising campaign for this. They said they're gonna do it. So we can't thank them enough. It's gonna be here as a result of not only CCO, but the Cancer Center Foundation. Because generally, you know, the installation costs, even with the MRI, at the time we had to pick up, it was the flip, as the government picked up or helped with, that's 3/4 of the installation cost, but we had to pay for the actual MRI. So the installation costs are far less than.
So in this case, it'd be like site preparation?
Yeah, making sure, Kevin Marshall is like a cement pad. You know, to drive it in, yeah, so. But the goal is plug and play.
It'll be in the actual building that's already there.
Yes, it's gonna be dropped in. So right now, as stated, it's a physical, empty space, literally.